Check the mic and make sure it sound right, boys.
Hello, how much of a fan of the Vision Transformers are you? Are you happy how Transformers, initially introduced for text, took over the state of the art in image classification? Or are you nostalgically looking back to convolutional neural networks? Miss Coffee Bean, do not come here with the nostalgia argument. ConvNets and their priors are still very much the kings of their own hill, look. The Swin Transformers, which are transformers at their core, do a lot of gymnastics to introduce a hierarchical processing in transformers. Hierarchical design that ConvNets always had. If transformers want to solve not only holistic tasks like image classification, but object detection and semantic segmentation, where attention to detail is required, attention, no pun intended. So if they want to solve these tasks, transformers need to process smaller patches than 16 by 16 pixels like ConvNets do. So how to compare ConvNets and transformers and make it fair? Sometimes transformers steal from ConvNets. I'm looking at you, Swin Transformer, with your hierarchical processing, and the credit for the performance gain goes to the transformer. But what about reversing the roles, letting a ConvNet steal from a transformer? How many things do we have to add to a ConvNet to make it as powerful as a transformer? Well, if you're interested in this question, you're in luck. What if me and Miss Coffee Bean told you that there is a paper which takes a standard convolutional neural net, a ResNet, and morphs it such that the design approaches a vision transformer? And spoiler, it surpasses the transformer in terms of performance. Hey, Miss Coffee Bean is spoiling the surprise here, so let's stop her and introduce our sponsor for today's video. Thanks to Weights and Biases for supporting me and this little coffee bean over here. You do not know who they are? Weights and Biases is an MLOps platform, helping you and your team to improve and accelerate the process of building and maintaining machine learning models. Do you want to track experiments, to save your model configuration so you can reproduce even that model which you stashed away months ago, which you now maybe want to reproduce but cannot remember its settings? Weights and Biases has got you covered on that front. Are you training a model and want to find the right hyperparameter configurations, but it seems more like alchemy than science to you? Then let Weights and Biases sweeps functionality find the optimal parameters for you during your lunch break. Don't worry, Weights and Biases is not hard to integrate, it just needs a few lines of code. And the best bit is yet to come. This is all for free if it's meant for personal use or for academic teams. So what are you waiting for? Check out Weights and Biases. Now, let's get back to today's paper making ConvNets fashionable again for the 2020s. With this paper, we witness how a convolutional neural net, or short, a ConvNet, steals modern training tricks that transformers usually benefit from to build the ultimate ConvNeXt architecture. This ConvNeXt is super interesting because by modernizing ConvNets step by step, one can better see where performance can be gained. Like, is it more the architecture? Is it more the training tricks? Is it more, I don't know, crazy design choices? And ConvNeXts are competitive with transformers, not only in image classification, but also on object detection and image segmentation, where the Swin transformer had its reign so far. Then let's follow the paper and see. What is it that ConvNets have that is so precious and we should keep it even in the era where transformers take over everything? Which steps do the authors take to modernize ConvNets into ConvNeXts? And what are the associated performance gains? What can we learn from all of this? Feel free to jump around in the video to watch the parts you're most interested in. Also note that some of the concepts we touch upon we will explain only briefly, but others are left a bit unexplained as they would deserve a video on their own. So, it's ConvNets versus transformers today. The authors introduced the paper by praising ConvNets. Miss Coffee Bean, how else their agenda is to resurrect the idea of convolutional networks? So the authors start, of course, by mentioning how the deep learning renaissance was driven by ConvNets in 2012. The introduction of AlexNet established the ImageNet moment in computer vision, and visual recognition turned from feature engineering to designing ConvNet architectures that learn their own features, like VGGNet, Inceptions, ResNet, DenseNet, MobileNet, EfficientNet, Net, RegNet. What do all of these networks have in common? Well, the convolution, a sliding window that processes the visual input in the same manner, so the parameters are shared between image locations. This is a big plus when bounded by computation. Convolutions also induce translation equivariance. Are you not sure what this means and why the authors use the word equivariance and not invariance? Well, then let Miss Coffee Bean's past self explain this in 60 seconds to you. We have an interesting question on our quiz where the majority was wrong. Oh. It's about convolutions and the difference between invariance and equivariance. Translational or shift invariance means that irrespectively of the position of a cat, the output of the convolution operation is the same, which it isn't since the feature map still reflects the original position. So this is actually equivariance, because when the position of the cat changes, the output changes in the same way, reflecting shift. And with the sliding kernel, this is exactly what happens. So convolutions are not shift invariant, but equivariant. If you got this wrong, it's okay, because these words are used interchangeably in language, except of highly mathematical contexts. Please mind that the question asks about the convolution only. It was a next day's trick question inquiring about the CNN as a whole. While convolutional layers do not make the CNN shift invariant, but only equivariant, it takes spatial pooling layers to make it approximately shift invariant by pushing information that was far away into approximately the same spot.
Okay, we got it. Convolutions are great. But what about transformers? Well, after the introduction of transformers for text processing in 2017, the transformer actually had some applications on image generation or image text understanding, applications which went widely unnoticed. So unnoticed that today's paper, like almost any other paper, does not mention this. The transformer architecture got properly noticed by the computer vision community when, of course, when it was proven to advance the state of the art on ImageNet. Okay then, what is so cool about transformers? First, the transformers as we know it from natural language processing, or short NLP, is more or less usable out of the box for images. Exception is, we cite the initial patchify layer, which splits an image into a sequence of patches of, for example, 16 by 16 pixels. And there we have it, the VIT. Watch our previous videos on this for context. VIT's scaling laws allows to increase the model size and the size of the training data, and it overcomes ResNets. But VIT's problems are just around the corner. Without the inductive bias introduced by sliding windows, the solution space of transformers is larger than for CNNs. Just imagine, a CNN by construction cannot converge to anything that is not translational equivariant. But a transformer very well can, because it misses this guiding bias. This is what we mean when we say the solution space of transformers is larger. The architecture is more flexible because the solution space is larger. Therefore, in the case where there is little training data to find the right solution in this bigger space, transformers are dependent on a lot of training tricks like heavy data augmentation, as we have seen with DEIT. But the biggest problem that transformers have is everything but ImageNet scenarios, so cases where the images are high resolution and the prediction must be dense. In this case, patchifying into 16 by 16 pixels might be too coarse to make right pixel level predictions, but if we were to make the patches smaller, this would quadratically increase the sequence length, because we would need more of these patches to cover the same surface. And we know that when we increase the sequence lengths for transformers, the compute and memory footprint increases again quadratically. To overcome this, hierarchical transformers such as the Swin transformer introduce sliding windows again, which makes them resemble very much with ConvNets in this aspect. Noting this, the authors cannot help but ask themselves, what if they would morph a ConvNet towards a Swin transformer? What would we see from this interpolation to answer the question we cite, How do design decisions in transformers impact ConvNet's performance? And imagine the authors wanted to know the answer to this so badly that they run the according experiments and write a paper about this. Then let's follow their steps of modernizing ConvNets to make them stylish enough for the 2020s. Since the style of the 2020s is definitely given by transformers, we mean that the authors make ConvNets more transformer-like. So step one, take a ResNet 50. The authors also have experimented with the larger ResNet 200, but if you want to know about that, read the paper, more specifically Appendix C. You should always anyway read the paper yourself, and you should not trust a PhD student and her coffee bean to tell you everything there is to know about a paper. Or should you? Okay, we have taken a ResNet 50, now what about it? Well, first and above all, the authors train it with similar training techniques as vision transformers are trained with. They use the AdamW optimizer, use more epochs, heavy data augmentation, regularization. All of this increased the performance of the ResNet 50 from 76.1% to 78.8% on ImageNet top 1 accuracy. So wow, lesson learned, I will not forget about these ingredients when baking my CNN-based models. The second thing they modernize after they are done with including the training techniques is something the authors call the macro design of the ResNet. For the stage ratio, they adjust the number of blocks in each stage and improve model accuracy. Then they make the sliding windows in the ResNet behave more like the patches in vision transformers. So with a larger kernel size and with a stride such that the sliding window does not overlap, this looks already much more like the non-overlapping patches in the transformer. This again increases performance, if only by a little bit. The third stage adopts the idea that ResNeXt had introduced before, namely the idea of inception, if you're old enough to remember that, of splitting, transforming and merging information. The keyword here is depth-wise convolutions, a special case of grouped convolutions where the number of groups equals the number of channels. Important to note, and here we cite from the paper, is that depth-wise convolution is similar to the weighted sum operation in self-attention, which operates on a per-channel basis, that is, only mixing information in the spatial dimension, end quote. And depth-wise convolutions, having reduced the number of flops, also reduce the accuracy, but by simultaneously widening the network, the performance is substantially improved. It's time for the fourth stage of the whole improvement process, which is the so-called inverted bottlenecks. We find it a little bit misleading here that the authors say that one important design in every transformer block is that it creates an inverted bottleneck, that is, the hidden dimension of the MLP block is 4 times wider than the input dimension. Hopefully we don't get something wrong here, but this is the case for every Swin transformer in particular, not every transformer in general. Because yes, in Swin transformers that work hierarchically, the outputs of 4 blocks get concatenated such that in the end the hidden dimension increases 4 times, but in any case, they want to copy this idea by using a, we quote, inverted bottleneck design with an expansion ratio of 4 used in ConvNets. And hooray, this increases performance too, if only by a little. The fifth stage introduces larger kernel sizes. This tries to equal the power of vision transformers that have a global receptive field and see the image at once through self-attention that spans the whole image. But Swin transformers limit the self-attention window, so if the authors increase the ResNet's window size, then they should reach the same compromise. This results in an increase in performance of nothing, but it's clear that small kernel sizes hurt the performance. And finally, the sixth and final stage comes with micro design choices such as replacing the rectified linear unit activation function with the Gaussian error linear unit used in BERT or GPT-2 or VIT. They are using the activation functions less often, as transformers also do in the MLP block only, and with the same motivation to do everything more transformer style, the authors also use fewer normalization layers because transformers use them less often than the ResNet as well. They are replacing batch normalization with layer normalization. Short reminder, in batch norm, a mini batch of data that has multiple examples and features associated to it, the normalization happens across the batch or sample dimension. The batch normalization effect is that the magnitude of the features is similar across data samples in the batch. Layer norm normalizes across the feature dimension such that per data sample, the features have around the same magnitude. Historically, layer norm was something that worked better for recurrent neural networks, whereas batch norm was mostly used in ConvNets. And surprise, all these micro modifications have a tremendous impact on performance, and by using separate downsampling layers, this enhanced ResNet achieves an accuracy of 82.0 ImageNet top 1 accuracy, exceeding the Swin transformer. And these results are comparable because the Swin transformer plays in the same league in terms of computation and size. If you're curious to know how this fares in the big model league, you just have to look at the gray bars in the figure, where they start from a ResNet 200 and add all these steps with similar gains. Okay. Cool, we have seen steady performance increase and really impressive numbers and results. But what are the lessons here with respect to our ConvNet versus transformer boxing match? So the first lesson here is that not only transformers, but modernized ConvNets scale too in terms of size and data. And we have not discussed the data aspect, I know, check out the additional experiments with more data in the paper. The second lesson is related to the tasks. ConvNets can compete in object detection and semantic segmentation with the Swin transformer, which we remember was a hierarchical version of VIT. Maybe you are wondering what exactly the novelty of this paper is. Well, we cite, it is also worth noting that none of the design options discussed thus far is novel. They have all been researched separately, but not collectively over the last decade. And while the authors here are genuine convolution advocates, by reading this paper, we must ask ourselves, what if the bigger lesson of this paper applies to other architectures too? What if, while everyone in NLP suddenly jumped onto the next stage dominated by transformers, forgot to stepwise improve RNNs or their tree RNNs or everything that is not fashionable anymore? So far, we thought that self-attention and the way that transformers process information in parallel highways is the recipe for success. But this paper suggests that it is rather the many seemingly tiny architecture hyperparameters and not the architecture itself that can tweak the way to state of the art. Another thing we wonder, and this is maybe something only the authors can answer, is whether the experiments were really conducted in the order presented in the paper and in this figure here. It is more plausible that these design choices were added in all possible orders and configurations and that the authors picked and presented everything where improvement over improvement can be seen. Don't get us wrong, we do not criticize the paper with this. Miss Coffee Bean just wants to warn me that science is not always this straightforward ascending line to the finish. And coming back to the contribution and to the novelty of this paper, even though no design option was presented, it is the art of putting everything together, or rather the power of brute forcing every available option, that makes this paper bear the fruits it does. And maybe a tiny critique that almost any paper in machine learning deserves. Let's not forget that papers do the comparisons they like and suit them best. Miss Coffee Bean will leave you to this tweet, also linked in the description below, where one of the VIT authors points out that ConvNeXts were compared only to plain VIT, while Swin and ConvNeXts had heavy augmentation. Judge for yourself, but also do not forget to count the number of times you took the baselines you liked the most. Miss Coffee Bean, stop teasing our audience. Let's rather talk about how we reached 10,000 subscribers this Christmas. Celebration video when? Miss Coffee Bean, Miss Coffee Bean, come back. Hey, don't leave us hanging here. Okay, bye. It sound right, boy.